name, sir?
Bugs Peyton.
What is it again?
I say Bugs Peyton. My name, Bugs Peyton.
Muggs Peyton?
Hey, schmuck. Bugs, not Muggs. Can't you understand? Was this the television? Yeah. Yeah.
What business are you in?
I'm a priest. Yeah, 3 months at the Mormon Tabernacle Temple in Idaho.
You look Jewish to me.
Doesn't everybody?
Maybe it's your appearance.
My what?
Your appearance. Your looks.
Well, I was seriously thinking of getting a nose job, yeah. That would straighten it out, wouldn't it?
Who's your dentist?
Who's what?
Who's your dentist?
Never been to one in my life, believe it? Never had to go to the dentist. I ate a lot of candy as a kid. All right, cut.
Well, I've got a warehouse in Los Angeles, and I've also got a storage company that's housing maybe 2,500 books of stills. I've got all of my films, all of the outtakes, all of the work that went into it, pre-production material. I must have 5-6 million feet of tape and film from 17 millimeter mag stripe film, sound film, to negative material, cutting material, the cutting print, the work print, the final print. Everything from the first television show that was ever photographed, kinescope. All the press, good and bad. There's 4 acres of land between this warehouse and the storage company that's housing all of my collection. But I've got just about everything.
Why do you want to keep absolutely everything?
I really don't know. I think it happened because of my father, who kept nothing of his work. And he told me stories of things that he did in our business that were glowing and beautiful and star-lit recitations of what went on in our business, and I have nothing to see, only to hear. And I think that was what prompted me. I don't know. I really don't know the reason for it. But it's a compulsion, because if I'm missing something, it gets me crazy till I get it.
Is it your way to prevent the passing of time?
No, I think that it's a reminder that time has passed. It has nothing to do with immortality. It's just that I would like, I guess psychologically, I would like someone to know that I had been here.
Jerry, you were born in New Jersey.
Newark.
Newark. How come so many comedians come from New Jersey?
Did you ever see New Jersey?
Yes.
Well, if you did, you'd know. New Jersey and New York was practically one. And the why of comedians coming from that sector was probably because of the Bourse Circuit, the Jewish mountains, where we would work and learn our craft. But that's probably why most of the Jewish comedians came from that area, or they migrated there.
La plupart des comics américains ont rodé tous leurs numéros dans ce circuit du Borscht, une chaîne hôtelière à clientèle israélite située dans les monts Catskill. Et Jerry, groom serveur à l'hôtel Browns de Loch Sheldrake, s'était fait remarquer par ses facéties et son talent de trouble-fête avant de s'essayer pour ses débuts dans un numéro de mime sur disques enregistrés.
I was 5 years old the first night that I performed with my mother and father. I didn't know until I was 10 that he got paid for me that night. But after 50 years of performing, you have to look to where it came from. It was my dad. My dad was my teacher. He was marvelous. He did everything, or I should say everything I do, he did, except he did it better.
Enfant de la balle, Jerry, après de courtes études au collège d'Irvington dans le New Jersey, suivit un itinéraire classique. Il fut d'abord serveur dans un drugstore, employé de magasin, ouvreur de cinéma, mais très vite, sans encouragement particulier de ses parents, il s'immissa dans le monde du spectacle par l'entremise du chef d'orchestre Louis Prima. il s'employa activement à réaliser ce rêve typiquement américain qui est de tourner le plus vite possible un bout d'essai pour le cinéma afin de devenir une grande vedette et de faire carrière à Hollywood.
Harvey
Poe.
What were you, a radio announcer? How old are you?
24.
Why?
Couldn't help it.
Can you handle a gun?
Oh.
Can you handle a gun?
Yeah.
Are you quick on the draw?
Oh.
Let me see you draw fast.
They're not fast, but they're polka dots.
No, no, no. Draw. Pull out a gun.
Oh.
Fast. Get it out.
The gun? Oh, it's just...
Very good. Never mind the western part. I don't think you can get going.
En 1946, Jerry rencontre Dino Crocetti, c'est Dean Martin, son aîné de 9 ans, au club 500 Atlantic City, et ils décident de mêler leurs numéros. Dean chante et Jerry l'interrompt, fait le pitre, crée le désordre et la folie. D'une boîte de nuit à l'autre, ils atteignent New York, débutent à la radio et à la télévision.
Art Wolf for Van Nuys, $25.
There's a couple of Mustangs.
Oh, yeah.
In the wing.
Hey, listen, we got to get these boys on because they've done a couple of great shows tonight, and they're very wonderful for coming out and helping us. Martin and Lewis.
Moving, we're really a target up here. The Jolly Tiger almost got dirty there.
Yes,
for a
you
minute.
Did, buddy.
Better hurry up, they're staring.
I don't mind them walking out, but they're beginning to walk towards us here. What are you bending the arm? What is this?
Some enchanted evening. You will see a friend. Hey, you. Bad?
They heard you. It wasn't funny.
All right.
Hey, you will see a friend. Across a crowded round.
Come back, Heathcliff.
Fly to her side. You have found her, you must never let her go.
I'll be right back, I will.
Oh, I say, sir, could you wait just a moment? I shan't be too long if you don't mind, sir.
Once you have found her, never let her go.
relax. Why, in France, we do nothing but relax, monsieur. Cigarette? Here we are. Pas de moi. Monsieur, all we do is relâcher.
Relâcher?
Relâcher.
Oh.
C'est moi, which roughly translated means...
When you're too tense, it's common sense to relax, c'est vous. The more you earn, the less you learn to relax, c'est vous. We French, you'll find, are more inclined to relax, c'est vous. Relax, 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 c'est vous. Your doctor feels they're all fulfilled to relax, say boo. You're in your prime, so now's the time to relax, say boo. The girls pursue those fellows who can relax, say boo. Relax, 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 say boo.
I don't have to try to relax, say boo. Chum, I'm much too numb to relax, say boo. Go hook some other schnook to relax, say boo. Relax, 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 say boo.
The last 16 bars of Swanee River, Dick. Here we go. It was my fault. I dropped the cane. So let's pick it up right from...
Stop, tell him.
No, I was telling him. You see, it's the last 16 bars of Swanee River. Now, oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Down in old Kentucky, horseshoes are lucky. Uh-huh. I was telling
him. Sure.
No, not yet. The last 16 bars of Swanee River. All right, put the cane down, take the hat off, stand there, and stop this stupid and pathetic nonsense. And the minute we walk on the stage, the judge can get the other thing screaming on your part, and I'm getting sick of it, do you understand? Thick, thick, thick. I immediately turn to tell the giddy giddy boy about the music for the benefit of the both of us so that we can do the dance in the proper fashion. If you can't stand there and protect yourself like a gentleman, I certainly don't know what I'm going to do with you, Dean. What's gotten into you, good heavens? All right, last 16 bars of Swanee River. Go straight ahead. Here we go. Last 16 bars of Swanee River. And watch the big finish. Go to the Star Spangled Banner if they don't applaud.
To you, Dean Martin, and this to Jerry Lewis. Ladies and gentlemen, Glenn Lewis.
Us, Jerry and I, like to talk as one. For being so graciously honored, it's hard to believe, but here
we
are, and more thrilled than
we
can ever tell you. There isn't really too much we can say.
Hey.
Oh, I'm sorry. Sorry, Jerry.
It's all right. There really isn't too much we
can say.
Except.
That we
accept.
Can say except.
We
are eternally grateful.
We
shall always remember this tribute.
We
will try to live up to what is expected of us.
We will write speeches together from now on.
Right.
And we thank you from the bottom of our hearts,
please.
That's enough of the speeches.
Yeah. Marilyn Monroe approuve. Elle vient de déclarer par voie de presse, Jerry, je le trouve sexy. Et par la même vient de le ranger parmi les séducteurs.
I still think this is crazy. We'll catch our death of cold.
Oh, shut up. I've got a couple of days before I have to get back to that miserable office of mine. I said we come down here for sun. We're going to get some sun.
There is no sun. It's raining like mad.
Didn't you ever hear of liquid sunshine? Now shut up and pull out some suntan oil.
You want me to put some on them, too?
What about them?
All right. And how about him?
What about him?
What about him? My darling brother was down in Palm Springs. Beautiful, warm sunshine. No rain, nothing, no. You had to insist that he come up here.
I can't control the weather.
And you can't control your jerky mind with its stupid thoughts either.
What kind of jerky stupid thoughts? All
here,
my life
stupid,
I've been
stupid,
along with you.
Stupid.
That's all you have given me.
Alone,
I've never thought about
all right,
that.
Always
I want to stop.
Always,
I want to get
right,
nobody's
alone,
going to tell me any
always.
And that's
I heard that Stan Laura was sick, and I called his apartment. And I spoke to him. And he was very delighted that I called and that I was concerned. And we met on the telephone. Then I went to see him at his apartment. And we spent Sundays together. In the last 5-6 years of his life, we were very close. And I learned more in those 5 or 6 years from our discussions than I could have ever learned in 100 years.
You found out you had many points in common, you told me.
Yes, there was. We had a great deal in common.
Especially in the relationship that he had with Oliver. And
he
the
had
one
the
you
same relationship with Ollie as I had with Dean. And Dean and I had a good working relationship because we both understood each man's role. Stan and Ollie had the same kind of relationship. And when Ollie died, it shook Stan very badly, so that he became paralyzed on one side.
All right, my love, carry on!
Oh, there it is.
Morning. Very good, now.
Everybody back, come on, everybody back.
You mean Ollie was more easygoing and Stan was always working, that's what you mean?
Stan was the writer, the creator, the director, and he was a workaholic like I am. Dean and Ollie liked to play golf, but they were both superior, magnificent artists when it came time to go before the cameras. And it worked very well with me and Dean because we didn't clash. We didn't get in one another's way, and it worked the same way with Stan and Ollie, and it was marvelous. But both Stan and I were astonished that we had so much in common. And I would send him scripts that I would write, and he would make little notes that he thought that was very good or that was very bad, and I listened to him.
Did he give you some advice?
He taught me one comedy rule. Tell an audience you're gonna do something, then do it, then tell them it's been done.
Would you give me an example of this?
Thank you.
Then Ollie did the look in the camera, and then Stan would tell the audience it's been done.
And then Ollie would try to do it and
yes, of course.
Fail, of course.
Jerry, did you ever win any prizes for your movies?
No, not exactly.
Why, Jerry? Well, oh, Ed, they'll ask the questions, yeah.
Well, I never received any prizes because they're more or less for home consumption, and we keep them for the gang that makes the movies. For instance, Dean makes most of the home movies with us. We were doing a movie about a month ago, and we were shooting all day Sunday, and Dean was supposed to come, and he's very important in the picture, and he was playing golf, and he called me and said he couldn't make it. So we had him killed.
You did what?
We had him killed.
They killed me off. I was supposed to be a gangster. I couldn't make it. I was busy putting.
He was busy playing golf, so we had someone get on the phone on a close shot and say, what? He was killed? So he was out of the movie.
Then this means that Jerry is a resourceful director. Is that right?
Well, yeah. Yeah, he's a resourceful director, if you want to use that kind of language.
Thank you.
Well, you know, when you mentioned this, the first thing that comes to mind is how many meals I had to cook for all those people that came to make the whole movie, because they were doing it on their days off, weekends, and I wasn't acting in all of them, you know, just the one. And we'd congregate every Saturday and every Sunday. And it was truly an experience for me, but also I feel that Jerry was learning a great deal about picture making, because what he would pick up at the studio, he'd practice at home.
Tonight, world premiere, Come Back, Little Shiksa, and a wonderful night it is.
You talk, honey.
No, Nancy. What did you think of the picture?
Well, I thought it was just wonderful, but you tell him, honey.
Oh, well, I thought it was wonderful, too. You know, when you struggled all your life with those quickies and those stinkers like King's Row and things like that, you dream of getting in a picture like this one. Maybe someday it'll happen to us.
Yeah. We'll just wait.
But I didn't get any bravos at the premiere. It wasn't good enough for that.
Let's speak about the premieres.
Yes.
They're usually where in your home, too.
Oh, yes, we have.
And who was invited? Some big people from Vermont?
Yes, our president and Mrs. Reagan were there, and Jeffrey Hayden, I remember, and let's see.
Hal Wallace,
and this Abby Mann, he was there. I mean, there were so many incredible names, you know. They all came in tuxedos.
And very seriously.
Very seriously, yes. And the playroom was decorated like a premiere, and folding chairs.
There were lights at the entrance.
Klieg lights, yes. We had Klieg lights, and we had a beautiful dinner afterwards. And
you used many famous actors and actresses. Which names do you recall, apart from Dean, Tony Curtis, and Janet Leigh, who were close family friends? When there are people like Wendell Corey, John Bromfield, who else?
Jeff Chandler, and as I said, a small shot of John Barrymore Jr., and I remember Mona Freeman did something with us. I think Shelley Winters did something, but I don't know which film.
Eat my breakfast. Would you think it'd be a good idea if I ate my breakfast?
What time are you due at the office, dear?
I hear.
What time are you due at the office?
About 3. No, about 2 o'clock. I have a very, very delicate operation today, but I don't care if it's brain surgery. You know, I cut the guy and help lift up the lip. I don't care.
Oh, it's nice, Ducky. I'll see you tonight, dear.
Okay, honey, Pop. I'll go in the kitchen and get my own coffee.
Now, there's been some talk that Dean and I are feuding. Well, you all know the feud is over.
I would like to say that... Oh, I'm sorry. I would like to say that Dean and I belong together. We belong together, and that's a song. It's the title of a song that we did in a TV, TV show, and we'd like to show it to you so that you can see how Dean and I feel about one another in this number. We hope you like it.
Well, you know, maybe you and me sort of,
Together both?
Yeah.
You mean Goofy and singing?
Yeah, sort of like, partners, you know.
Partners.
We belong together. Like romance and flings, horses and strings.
Juleps and mints, lighters and flints.
We belong together. We go strong together. Like honey and bees, pizzas and cheese.
Benches and parks, Groucho and Marx.
We belong together. Delilah found romance with Samson. Her fella, the Dodgers, are nowhere without Campanella. We belong together. Like judges and fines, Duncan and Hines.
Buttons and bows, Broadway and shows.
Like Fibber, McGee and Molly. Luke, Fran and Ollie. Buddy, we belong together. Delilah on romance with Samson. Her fella, the Dodgers, are nowhere without Campanella. We belong together.
Like what?
Like judges and fines, Duncan and Hines.
Buttons and bows, Broadway and shows. Like
Fibber, McGee and Molly. Cook, LeBron and Ollie. Buddy, we belong together.
They did some marvelous things together, and their friendship, so to speak, was a kind of marvelous image for people in my age. It was something funny and charming and gay. It was...
They were spontaneous.
And spontaneous.
Improvised things. They really did improvise.
Yeah, they were funny together, and Dean was funny, and Jerry was funny. They were funny. It's so complicated by now, and so involved with egos and personalities, who it's impossible to unravel.
The unknown.
build a world of my own. No one knows better than I myself. I'm by myself.
Ce traumatisme de la séparation, Jerry l'a éprouvé pendant 20 ans. Et même si leurs deux carrières s'en sont relativement bien portées, elle a laissé de profondes cicatrices. Mais ce traumatisme, c'est l'Amérique tout entière, frappée dans deux de ses idoles, qui l'a sans doute le plus mal supporté. Elle en a fait retomber toute la charge sur le seul Jerry, plus vulnérable dans son image d'amuseur que Dean dans la sienne de viveur.
Where we registered.
Right this way.
Hold it. Hold it.
Hold back.
Hold it. Back. Hold it. Hold it. Hold it. Stop with the brushing. Now, we've been together a long time. I've asked you many, many things, and you've come up back for me. But now I'm asking you to hold it. Stop pushing. Stop rushing. Just hold it. Now, we're all adults, and I'll expect you all to conduct yourselves in such a fashion as an adult will. Hold it. I've never asked you this, but I'm asking you now simply, purely, hold it!
You may register in your suite. This way, please.
All right, thank you very much. I have to...
Back!
Now, we're going to go in the elevator, and we're going to go single file like nice people. Remember I told you? Hold it, Leon.
Yes, Chief.
Who are all these people?
They all work for you, Chief.
Mm-hmm. And who's the guy with the straw hat?
He's the guy that tells you who we are.
Oh, well, that's good to have such a thing, because I wouldn't have known it. I got such a bunch of people. Oh, this is a very nice room, Ben. Where's the bed? Oh, it's the elevator. I'm sorry. Will you stop? Wait, don't push. Folks, just... That's it. Just file them. Just... No, move the left. Would you? That's it. Now, let me get into this. Let me get into the thigh. That's it. Fine. Will you get off? You're stepping on my sway. Will you stop with the brushing? I'm awfully sorry, Ben. These people are just so over-anxious. And I appreciate it because, you know, you've got to have your staff. I've got the barber and the gardener, and I've got the people that assist me. See, when I do the shows, I try my best to do what I can to perform for the people, and I need the elements, you see, and all of these people function for me. And that's why they're stop rushing.
Thank you.
If it works, that is. Will it make me strong? Or will it make me big? How do I know I'll be anything but what I am? Wait a minute, maybe I'll be someone I don't want to be. Yet on the other hand, I could be something I've always wanted to be.
Now listen, you guys, and listen hard. This is the last time I'm going to tell you. The little old lady on North 4th Avenue is a perfect hit. She's loaded. I get over there and pick up everything what ain't nailed down. On second thought, take a hammer. Well, what are you waiting for? Go on.
But, boss, that little old lady's your mother.
I know that. Where do you think I got my information from? Come here, big idiot.
Mm-hmm.
Douglas Fairbank? I knew you'd remember. Friend, you know something? Health, hygiene, sanitation are things that I stress in my home. Do you stress them in yours? Do you think about your body? Do you consider it? Do you take care of it? Well, we have Vic Trainee Gym. Vic Trainee is one of the finest gymnastic teachers and bodybuilders in the entire world. They can be found in most any city in America. Go and build your body up. Build it up so that you too can be masculine and strong. You'll find at Vic Trainee Gym, they have the finest men with masculine, fantastic bodies that you've ever seen in your life. Some of them have walked in weaklings, those that were kicked with sand, those that were called skinny, are now like our guest tonight. From Vic Trainee Gym, Mr. Charles Herrick. Mr. Herrick, we're very happy to have you here with us. We're happy to have you in this film to tell all those, the theater goers all over America, what wonderful work Vic Trainee Gym do. Now, here's a perfect example. Here's a gentleman who weighed 104 pounds before going to Vic Trainee. Look at the way this man is built over a period of just 11 years. It's just, I'm thrilled. You know, I kind of choke up when I...
Oh, God.
When I look at this wonderful specimen. And at Vic Trainee, you get... May I just see your hand for a second? It's just wonderful at the wonderful care you get at Vic Trainee Gym. And it's fun there, it's inexpensive, and it'll give you a new lease on life. No, it'll give you a new lease on life. Do you agree that Vic Trainee Gyms are the best gymnasiums in the world, Mr. Herrick?
Oh, we have oodles of fun.
So you see, there's absolutely nothing but magnificent care. Oh, I hope you'll wait around till after the feature. Now, we hope that you will enjoy the continuation of our film.
Is that dirty? Very dirty to sit.
Opera. Yearning.
That's beautiful. Thank you.
I would like to give you and the organization a $5,000 check on behalf of my two grandchildren, Amanda and A.J. Lambert, because they're healthy. You do that one more time, we're going to buy the furniture. Listen, I have a friend who loves what you do every year and who just wanted to come out and say, would you send my friend out, please? Okay, well, okay, where is he? We just turn him out here. Come here. Break it up. I think it's about time, don't you?
And thank you.
Yeah, I think it's about time.
You son of a bitch. Should have been a Jew that did it.
We could whip the world without the guns of Navarro. There they are, folks.
That kind of intense, I mean, that's stronger than any love affair, any marriage, that sort of working relationship. So it was an amazing moment to see that on the telephone.
So how you been?
Oh,
You know, it seems like we haven't seen each other for 20 years.
Yeah. Well, you know, there was all those rumors about our breaking up, and then when I started the show and you weren't here, I believed it.
I'll show you guys to your room if you like. The lights are out upstairs, so follow me.
Well, he drinks a lot, this kid.
So you working?
I work 6 weeks a year at the Megum.
The Megum?
And 6 days I do a roast. And
would you excuse us a minute?
I just want to see the wires are all right.
Gee, it's nice to see you.